I was kneeling and I was praying and to Jesus, my evening prayer, and suddenly a voice talked to me and said, Leonard, pray only to God, don't pray to Jesus.
This is the Dean Show.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, assalamu alaikum, greetings and peace. I have a special guest here on the Dean Show to tell us his story. He has a unique background. He speaks multiple languages. He's traveled the world and he's here on the Dean Show. His name is Leonard Wingard. Assalamu alaikum, Leonard. How are you?
I am doing good, thank you.
Now, there's a word for speaking the amount of languages that you speak. It's a polyglot. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
How many languages do you speak, actually?
Well, I speak Spanish, my best language, Swedish also, and English. Those I speak basically in the same manner, fluently. Then I speak German, my mother's language, and Portuguese as a result of multiple, many visits to Brazil.
Wow, amazing. So, do hablo español?
Hablo español, claro que sí.
Uno poquito, huh?
Un poquito.
Yes. Sprechen Sie Deutsch?
Ich spreche Deutsch auch.
Wow.
Sie sprechen auch?
Ja, pričaš auch malo bosanski. Any Bosnian?
No.
No, not yet. Okay.
We got to
add that into there.
Okay, good.
So tell us a little bit about your background. You were born in Cuba?
I was born in Cuba, that's correct. Mm-hmm. And can say my story really begins when I was 6 years of age. I was going to a Catholic school. It was nuns in a monastery. And so it was obviously the Catholic religion. What's unique about that is not the school per se, but because we were taught to pray to Jesus, our evening prayers, to direct them to him. And so I did that. But one evening while I was praying, suddenly a voice talked to me and it said, Leonard, pray only to God, not to Jesus. That was it. I looked up and to see who had spoken to me. There was nobody there. So
Wow. Hold on. Repeat that last part. It was just like for people who weren't paying attention. You said how did that happen again? Don't pray.
Well, I was at my bedside and I was kneeling and I was praying and to Jesus, my evening prayer, and suddenly a voice talked to me and said, Leonard, pray only to God, don't pray to Jesus. And that was it. Nothing more. I opened my eyes to look and see who had talked to me, and there was nobody around. So I feel it was a very, very unique.
Were you conscious? I mean, were you asleep or
No. I was
a dream. Was this a dream?
No. As I say, I was praying every evening, as I had been taught by the nuns, to pray to Jesus and thank him for everything. So I this voice came from nowhere. Well, it had to come from somewhere, but there was nobody there talking to me, simply saying, Leonard, pray only to God, not to Jesus. So as from that moment on, I have always prayed to God only.
Wow. So previously you were praying to the mighty messenger, the prophet Jesus, peace be upon him.
That is correct.
Who we love and revere as one of the mightiest messengers that God Almighty ever sent. I mean,
we know that the Christians say they believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that we know he isn't. But at that time, I knew what I had been taught. So I feel it is one of the most unique occurrences that anybody could have had, and myself.
So your background, you came from a Christian background. You were brought up as a Christian?
Well, my parents were not religious at all, but there was no other school where to put me that was, let's say, gave a good education. So it became that school, the monastery that was led by nuns, Catholic nuns. So that was it, but it has always been there as something very unique in my life.
So around what age was this when this happened?
Six. I was six, somewhere in my sixth year.
6 years old?
Yes.
And you still remember that vividly?
Oh yeah, that is the, I think, one of the main occurrences in my life. It's impossible to forget.
You'll never forget that?
No, yeah. Absolutely not.
So then life goes on. So then
hold
from
a
that,
moment. My hearing is not very good, so I need this. Okay.
So Leonard, from there, tell us more about your life. What went on from there?
Well, it wasn't anything very happy. I was born in 1934, so this was 1940. My father died only a year later. He went to get the flu injection, and that killed him. We couldn't go back to Europe. My father was Swedish and my mother German. We had to stay in Cuba until there was an opportunity to go to Europe to our relatives. So it was until October. Well, we moved from there to the next large city, which was Santiago de Cuba, or is, until we in October of 45 took a Swedish cargo boat to go to Sweden. The very unique thing with that trip was that we ran into a hurricane. Right the first day on the ship, we went to the Atlantic Ocean and into a hurricane. It was one of those, not the worst of hurricanes, but I still remember seeing through the porthole the waves, how the ship was going up and down, the waves, enormous waves. I couldn't tell how high, but I estimate them to maybe some 20 meters of height, and very scary. So we got to Sweden, to Gothenburg. From there we took a train to Stockholm, where we were to live, and began to go to school. I didn't speak any Swedish then, so had to begin learning Swedish. Something happened that began to drive me, which was that I became very, very ill. The weather was terrible. Have in mind that coming from the tropical Cuba to that terrible environment, I hated it. And I was hospitalized because I became so ill. So I gave myself, I promised to myself, I was going to go back to Cuba one day. And that drove me and drove me and drove me. Of course, I knew that I had to go to school. I had to do a lot of things before getting there. One of the things that happened that is something important in my life, I went to the Royal Swedish Navy. I became a telecommunications service person, specialized on the radar systems. Why is this important? Well, it something happened later on in my life that was important that I had a specialty. Anyhow, so I went to school and I was came out from there, and I when I finished, I there was an ad in a newspaper by Ericsson, the Swedish telecommunications company. I sent in my resume, and I indicated that I spoke Spanish and English, which for a guy my age and coming out from school in Sweden was extremely unique. So I thought that I would get a job. It took only a little while over the interview, and the job was mine. It was, I could say, the first step to going back to Latin America, not to Cuba, obviously.
Yes.
So what happened then, I had been traveling in Latin America for a few years when Ericsson sent me to Colombia in South America with my family as an expatriate to work in the Ericsson subsidiary there. Something very interesting happened. I have an alarm system coming in.
Okay, it should be fine now. Sorry about that.
Okay.
Continue.
Okay, it's gone. Something, I mean, somebody must be crazy in his mind, because what I did, I decided to go back to Latin America and took another Swedish cargo boat with my new family, obviously. And so we went to Gothenburg, we took the boat. We are now in 1967. And what was so incredible is that we are in the English Channel in heavy fog, and the ship stops moving. So I asked one of the crew, what's happening? And he said, our radar is down.
The radar was down?
The radar was down. So I told him, you know, I am a trained radar specialist in the Swedish Navy. So could I have a look at the equipment? So he went to see an officer, and the officer took me right away to the radar. I opened it up, but so I asked, do you have any instruments, spare parts? Nothing of the kind. So I opened it up, as I said, and I began looking around the, it's very simple kind of components at that time. So I found a resistor that was burned, and I said, since you don't have components, do you have a commercial radio that I could take a look and see if I can find a similar component? And I got it. And moments later, I asked, you have a couple of cutters and a soldering, whatever it is called. And he gave it to me. I cut out the burnt resistor, put in the other one, and the radar was up and functioning. But I say it's kind of unique that I went to that training and that I was back on a sister boat, identical to the one that I had taken many years ago, 27 yeah. years ago to be. So I thought that's amazing. Anyhow, so let's jump over a lot of years. I was in Colombia. I made
before you go on to there, Leonard, let me ask you something.
Yes.
So when your father passed away, how old were you?
I was seven.
So you were seven.
Seven.
And you said he went to get a flu injection,
yes.
What's a flu injection? A flu shot?
Flu shot, yes.
That's supposed to protect you from the flu and from possibly dying.
We're talking about 1941, so things were not.
He took the shot, and then how far later did he pass away?
Well, he came home, and next day his arm was swollen. I can remember him sitting there and in pain, and so they had to call an ambulance. This was the next day, and on Christmas Eve, the 24th, my mother came home and said, "We have no daddy longer. He's gone." Wow. So that I mean, it's amazing that something like that, of course, that changed and shaped my life in a totally different way as it would have happened if he had kept on being alive. Mm-hmm. So I had to take care of a lot of things myself in my young age and develop, let's say, a way of being that was entirely mine, because my mother didn't speak Swedish. So in Sweden, we tried to speak Spanish, but we were not allowed to do that because we lived at the home of an aunt of mine, and she said, you can speak English, but no Spanish. So
what got you interested, going fast forward,
yes,
from your early life now to the mid and then moving forward, how long ago did you actually accept Islam? And what got you interested or curious to look into Islam?
Well, see, this is something incredible, because the beginning of it all happened when I made my promise to go back to Latin America, because that started something that I didn't realize until much later, that I had set in motion what one could call the creative powers of my mind. And so when we came, later on, I moved to the US, 1980. 1980 happened, three important things happened to me that have some relation with this. And the first one, I became employed by Motorola in Chicago. I went to a Silva course where I learned about the powers of the mind, and I became interested in prophecies. Okay, prophecies is not so important in this, but the Silva course was important. So in my job, I had a very important mission, and that was that Motorola gave me to introduce the new American cellular systems to Latin America. So I began to travel, and I traveled a lot. I made many friends. I helped many people to learn about the new cellular systems. Okay, so now we come. I'm out from there. I am back with Ericsson, and I worked with Ericsson for some time. But at the end of it all, I wanted to write a book. And this is the important thing. I began to write about my experiences working in Latin America, the different things that I had made in different countries. So there was a catch there. I didn't call this a book a memoir. I gave it the title that was How I Attained My Goals by Using the Creative Powers of the Mind. So I began to study about the creative powers of the mind, and I realized the Hindus and Buddhists were the ones that knew more than anybody else. But at the end of the road there, I found that they didn't know anything about where this all originated from. So I decided to look into Jewish Bible. In the book of Genesis, chapter 2, there talks about the God's creation of Adam, but it is about all we know. He took some soil, made a figure of that, blew of his breath into this figure that became Adam, and that was it. That's it. It cannot be possible that's an event so important wasn't described in any way. So I said, where do I go from here? I had heard of the Quran. I obviously knew about the Muslims and Islam, but I didn't know any Muslim. I didn't know absolutely nothing.
When you say absolutely nothing, were you affected by much of the misconceptions, by much of the propaganda?
No. I hadn't been interested in any way. I was, let's say.
But did the news, did the news, like, did you watch news media? Because they're always trying to portray Muslims as terrorists or, you know, no. backwards or no. Did you get affected by any of that?
No. I wasn't affected at all. What happened now was that I decided to get myself a Quran without anybody telling me anything to do that. So I went out to find a Quran that I thought was easy to learn from, English language, of course. And I found one that I have realized afterwards is not used very much. But for my interest, I thought it was very, very good because it was very easy to read. You have out on the border, you have a few words about what is in the text, which made it very quick to find what whatever you wanted to look for. So I began to study it, and I became very surprised. I had never in my life imagined anything, since I didn't know anything, that Allah, God, as I always call him, I haven't used the word Allah, in any case, God had authored this fantastic book, and that he had given the book to his new prophet Muhammad through his archangel Gabriel. And I thought that is amazing. It's something that I couldn't for my life have imagined even. So I read more, and the more I read, the more interested I became. Excuse me. So I need to take some water.
That's it. That's interesting that the more, because your mind was, I asked you, it was free from much of the garbage that's put out there, and it was clear, and your heart was open, you were receptive, and you Absolutely. just read the book. You know, you started reading the translation of the Quran, and yes. things started to open up. And now, what was it at the end? How long did it take you to invest? You're a smart individual, just like the guy. You have Navy experience. You're over there fixing, you know, the radar on the ship. You're someone who's trained to use his mind, multiple languages. You're a smart intellectual. You're an author also. So now you're putting Islam to the test.
Let me interrupt you. I had begun to also study. I studied the issue of prophecies, and it has really nothing to do with this issue. But I found that in reading the Quran, there was an amazing amount of prophecies. And since I knew very well in detail all most prophecies in the Jewish Bible and the Book of Revelation and the Christian Bible, I saw that there was a something that went in the same way. It couldn't have come from anybody else than from God.
You determined that after your study that the Quran could not have come from anyone other than God Almighty Allah.
Well, I reading, because in the book, in the introduction, it has a very large introduction to what happened with the with the new prophet, how he became approached by Gabriel, and so I accepted. I had no reason not to accept it, that God had altered the Quran. But instead of him, like he did with Moses, talk with him directly and so on, he chose a totally different approach, which was to send his prophet Gabriel to talk with Muhammad, and that Muhammad, an illiterate person, he couldn't have written anything at all of what's in the Quran. So he was given verbally the what is or today the text of the Quran, and it went on for, what is it, from 620 to 40, about 20 years, and he received all the information. So that I thought was amazing. So I learned, I read more and more. I became extremely interested. And let's say that to great extent, it was because of the prophecies. But what I found so incredible is how much God talked about his creation of Adam and how Satan came to be as a result. I thought that was incredible. And I thought that how is it possible that all of this is said in this book and in the Jewish Bible, there is really nothing. So my thinking was that what happened in the Jewish Bible, it was God tells his prophet Jeremiah in the book of Jeremiah chapter 8, he tells him that his law had been changed, his law being the book of Moses. I cannot remember.
The Torah,
yes. So I realized that the Torah had been completely changed because God tells his prophet that it had been done. So that again was something that I thought was amazingly important, and especially because what happened, as I believe and as I came to conclude, was that basically every mention of Satan had been taken away. So Satan could live around us and nobody understood that he existed and exists, and that he is the guy who is doing our lives so difficult. Anyhow, so I came to realize that from the Quran that God is the giver of everything. We have our memory, our feelings. We have so much more. We have the powers of the mind coming from him, nowhere else. So that concluded my search in regards to the powers of the mind. So I could write it in my book. I wrote a chapter about that. Well, this has nothing to do with the whole thing, but my book, I tried to get it published, and it didn't go well because I was told that since I wasn't known, nobody wanted to take on to write about my book. So anyhow, so we go along, and I was attending a Christian school only because I became interested in the issue of religious history. And I became friends with a professor in one of the schools, and he invited me to attend his lectures. So in doing that, he one day said that he invited his pupils to go with him to different religions and talk with the leadership, so to say. So, and he mentions about Islam, and he mentions also, I'm sorry, this is moving out. So he mentions about the mosque in Richardson, this one.
That's the one that you're currently at with Imam Shpandim.
Yes, but see, I, at that point, we're talking about 2000, let me see, 2007.
Is that when you took your Shahada, when you embraced?
No. We have to go quite a few years into the future. So I called up the then Imam, whose name is Yusuf Kavaksi, and I was able to talk to him. I told him why I was calling, and I would like to have the opportunity to meet with them and get to know something more about Islam. And he immediately said I was welcome. He invited me a few days later. I came here in the same office, and we became very good friends over the next few years. And he had invited another person, Brother Adel El Said. He's not with me because he's home very ill, but Adel and I became very good friends. He taught me a lot about Islam, and I picked up more and more and more until, let's say, this was now 2017, exactly four years ago. he brought me here to go through my Shahada, and so I converted to become a Muslim.
Wow, this is an amazing day for you, was it?
it absolutely it was.
So in the last few minutes that we have, tell us, now you're in the community there with Imam Shpendim in Texas?
Well, I am not. See what happens, my wife is Christian, relatives are Christians, so they don't even know that I have become a Muslim. She doesn't even know that I wrote the book that is the unfortunate destiny of our planet and us that became published a year ago. No very good luck there, because I believe the publisher wasn't good at all, but it was what I could afford. So, and he also made a big mistake of, when it was published, to indicate that it was a religious book. Prophecies have nothing to do with religion other than they happen to be in the in religious scriptures, like the Jewish Bible, the Book of Revelation, and the Quran. So the book has come nowhere. But so I live, one could say, a double life. Mm-hmm. One is I come here to the mosque. I meet with Brother Spendim. We have become very good friends. And so we talk with each other now and then. And we have interchanged a lot of information, because obviously he knows some about the what's written in the book of in the Jewish Bible. And there are so many interesting things there, that because they are explained, and there is a lot of text about them. Like, for instance, the one of the most important of the prophets, I'll come back to this prophet. In chapter 6 in his book, is the whole chapter is dedicated by God to talk about the matter of understanding. And it's very, very interesting, because we get to understand that many, many people, even today, 2,700 years later, don't have given the gift of understanding. So people make decisions based on the knowledge without having the proper understanding. Mm-hmm. In the Britannica, in my Britannica Atlas, in the introduction, it is said that it is written that there is an enormous gulf between the knowledge of something and the understanding of it. So I believe it is one of those things that nobody realizes that it's happening today. So I talk about these issues, but say that's where I reached. But I had learned so much that I never in my life could have imagined that. I was hoping that my book would be able to go forward, because I have a whole chapter dedicated to this matter of understanding. And it's mentioned in the Quran, not so much maybe, but in the Book of Revelation, it we learn that understanding is something that is given through the wisdom that God gives to us, which is mentioned also in the Quran. There is a specific place where this is said, that God gives the wisdom to whoever he wants and the understanding. So, but my book didn't go anywhere. So I'm trying to get to that point to see how it can come out, because there is a lot of good teaching in that book, as I believe from my old, what I have learned in my life.
We got a couple minutes left. Okay. Can you tell us, so what is it we can imagine, like many people who accept Islam, because you weren't overwhelmed with all of the negative, the stereotypes, the propaganda, but I'm guessing that probably your wife and others, there might be some sort of backlash if they found out, because maybe they possibly been affected with some of the propaganda, the negativity about Islam.
No, I don't think so. I don't think I think the problem is the lack of good information in respect to all of this. But I realized very early on, and I cannot remember at what point, but I realized that there is so much. I don't want to use inappropriate words, but so much negativity that the Christians say about Islam, about the Quran, because they don't have the slightest idea of what they're saying. So that is an important issue that I don't know how one could address it to overcome all that negativity. But I think that there is a need to go more into depth into what is the Quran compared to what there is before, that would make things change in regard to what people can learn from this and change their ways of being.
Yeah, and that's why we do this program, to clear up the misconceptions, to give people a very simple yet profound experience by hearing stories like yours and getting the truth with the right message about Islam. So thank you very much for sharing a little bit about your story. Can you tell us the name of your book, and if someone wanted to look into it?
Yes, it is The Unfortunate Destiny of Our Planet and Us. See, prophecies, when we read the prophecies and learn to understand them correctly, there is no salvation for this planet. This planet is destined to become a dead planet, and God says it in through two of his prophets. One is Zephaniah, and through Zephaniah, God says it directly, I am going to destroy mankind. There are not going to be any survivors. But the religious people, they don't want to get into that. They stay out, and they do a lot of bull-ass talk about the whole thing. But in we have a lot in the Quran that talks about the end of the world. Only that the way how it is described doesn't tell us that. But there is a lot. I can tell you there is so much of prophecies that tell us exactly where we are going. And I can tell you that my early studies took me into the studies of the global warming. And I realized that the global warming has gone so far that doing anything up in the air to the atmosphere to reduce the outlet of those poisonous gases, it will not change anything, because there is no way that the warmed up oceans that are melting at a quicker and quicker pace are going to be able to go back and stop doing it. It right there is really the indication that there is nothing that can be done. And I am, from all the prophecies I read and what I have read and learned from the global warming, all those articles that have been written for years and years, we are very, very short time away from the end of this planet, unfortunately. I would like to say something positive about it, but anybody who takes my book and reads it will find out why and how and when it's going to happen.
So that's the
You go ahead. I hear you.
Yeah, that was the one thing when Prophet Muhammad was asked about the end of times, he clearly made it known that this is something that no one knew but the creator of the heavens and earth. Yes, there are signs, but what have we prepared for that day? That was the ultimate message. What have we prepared? Are we worshiping God Almighty Allah the way He wants to be worshiped? Are we living Islam how it's supposed to be lived, by obeying our Creator, doing good deeds, and preparing for that day that's inevitably coming, the end of this life? So
right.
I want to thank you.
Thank you. Well, okay.
Now, go ahead, finish your thought. We got 1 minute left.
Okay. Well, but see, in all these scriptures, we learn that God is against evil, and that evil is what is making all this happen to us. So there was never a critical point of going back, because from the very beginning, God saw. He saw that what would happen to us, to our planet, and He was trying to warn. His prophecies were warnings to obviously the Jewish people, but they never made any mention. Like God told them, you have to share your what you have learned through me to other people, which it said in the Quran, they never did. So that's where we stand.
Mm-hmm. Leonard, it was very nice talking with you. Thank you very much for sharing your story. Inshallah, God willing, it could be a benefit for so many people.
I hope so. I am very happy you gave me this opportunity, and I hope we can continue in some other shows.
Thank you very much. May God Almighty Allah continue to bless you. Assalamu alaikum.